ज्ञापकाय च धर्मस्य सर्वधर्मस्वरूपिणे अवतार वरिष्ठाय रामकृष्णाय ते नमः। ब्रह्मानन्दं परमसुखदं केवलं ज्ञानमूर्तिं द्वन्द्वातीतं गगनसदृशं तत्त्वमस्यादिलक्ष्यं एकं नित्यं विमलमचलं सर्वधी साक्षिभूतं भावातीतं त्रिगुणरहितं सद्गुरुं तं नमामि। என்னுடைய ப்ரோக்ராம், டுடேஸ் ப்ரோக்ராம் இஸ் 7 PM to 8 PM டாக் அண்ட் ப்ரணாம்ஸ் போத் மிக்ஸ் டுகெதர் ஓன்லி 1 hour, ஸோ இட் இஸ் ஆல்ரெடி 7:45. ஸோ தி ஸ்பீச் கேனாட் பி லாங்கர் தென் 15 minutes, தட் இஸ் எனஃப் டு அண்டர்ஸ்டாண்ட் தி க்ளோரி ஆஃப் குரு. 15 minutes ஆர் மோர் தென் எனஃப் இஃப் யூ ஆர் ரிசெப்டிவ் எனஃப். திஸ் குரு பூர்ணிமா இஸ் தி இஸ் ஆல்சோ கால்ட் ஆஷாட பூர்ணிமா அண்ட் ஆல்சோ கால்ட் வியாச பூர்ணிமா. வியாச இஸ் த கிரேட்டஸ்ட் ஆஃப் தி ரிஷீஸ் ஹூ ஹேஸ் கிவன் அஸ் த வேதாஸ் இன் தர் ப்ரெசன்ட் ஃபாரம். தேர் ஃபோர் ஹீ இஸ் கால்ட் தி குரு ஆஃப் தி குருஸ், குரு குரு குருணாம். So his birth is associated with this Guru Purnima. So this is observed all over the country, but every Vedic followers of Veda, so every Hindu observes this Guru Purnima. So today we are also observing it. In the morning we had puja for Sri Ram Krishna and special offerings, and in the evening this function was held more in the evening. It should have been done in the morning itself along with the special puja, but we know that under the circumstances none of you or most of you would not have been able to attend if you had this in the morning. Sri Ram Krishna did not want anything to be a mechanical, he wanted everything to have some meaning. So all this puja, all this celebration of Guru Purnima, if none of you were able to attend, so if we had performed some rituals in the temple, it would have been a mechanical observance. Sri Ram Krishna would not have liked it. So we said some puja for Guru Maharaj and offering for him and aarti, that was done in the morning. That was all right. So the main puja that is concerning the devotees, the followers, the appreciators, the lovers of God, it should be in the evening when all of them will be, most of them will be free. They cannot, all of them cannot take leave. Not they do not want to take leave, but it is not given even if they want. We have seen in many cases people want to come, but leave is not available. It is impossible to get leave. So we took that into consideration, and from several years we are observing all this celebration in the evening. Today also in the evening we had the 108 Namarchana, then afterwards special bhajan, then the aratrikam. After the aratrikam, so we had these two, one is pranam, another is a short talk. Some of them wanted the talk to precede the pranam. I said on the Guru Purnima day, pranam is more important. So people come from long distance, people have come from different states also. So let the pranam be over. Afterwards, whatever time is left, we can talk about the Guru Purnima. So this is Vyasa Purnima, usually called Guru Purnima. It is a holy day for everybody, irrespective of language, class, creed, caste, nothing. No barrier is here to observe this Guru Purnima. And this Guru Purnima is observed to remember our gurus, whoever may be that guru, from whichever sampradaya we may be coming. Today this Guru Purnima is the day of the Guru. Who is this Guru? The God Himself comes as in a human form or in a divine form as a Guru to show us the way for the spiritual enlightenment. The other secular enlightenment of learning 3 hours, learning alphabets, learning literature, science, art, and so many other secular knowledge, it opens our eyes to a little extent. It is called the preliminary knowledge, aparavidya. But that is not enough. That concerns only our body and the external world. So all the knowledge concerning the external world and our physical body and senses, this is called secular knowledge. All that alone is not enough. It is good, but not enough. What more is required? We are not only bodies. We are somebody who there is a mind behind the body. Behind the mind there is the Atman. And Atman is our real self. What we say, what we call ourselves as we or I, it is the Atman, it is not the body, it is not the mind, it is the Atman. So we must know something about this Atman also. It is this Atma that is inside this mind and body and in this world. And if this Atma is to enjoy the world, the Atma must know that it is my body, it is my mind, and how to enjoy this one. The enjoyer, the observer, the knower, the person who says I know, the person who says I enjoy, the person who says I am living, I am here in this world, it is neither our body nor our mind nor the external world. It is that Atman that is inside. This Guru, he gives us knowledge about our Atman. The other teachers, the college teachers, school teachers, they give us knowledge about this external world, at best about our body and senses. But who runs this body and mind, and who is behind this body-mind complex that no secular knowledge can give you? It is a spiritual knowledge. So the teachers that teach you that we are not the body and the mind, we are that force which is driving the body and the mind. And it is the same force that is driving this whole world also. What is driving this whole world? In the world we see a rhythm everywhere. People are born, they become young people, then middle-aged people, then old people. Then they pass away from the world. And there is a circle of this human cycle. Similarly, the seasons come. Never does a season miss. One season does not precede or follow. Exactly the same rhythm it goes. First you will get the summer, afterward the rains will come, afterwards winter will come, after winter again the summer comes. At any time have you seen in these thousands and thousands of history, one season coming earlier than the other, making a competition? It never happens. Tremendous discipline, that is tremendous harmony, tremendous rhythm is kept there. Whenever there is rhythm, always there is a force behind it. In your own house, you could have observed, if you have got 4 or 5 children, may not be your own, other children also may be there. If 4 or 5 children are at home, if they are silently sitting or doing something in a very rhythmic way, know for certain the head of the house is there. If the head of the house is out, you allow these 4 or 5 children, they will make a hell of your house. Any rhythm, any order, always means there is somebody who maintains the order. Similarly, this whole world, whole universe, creation, it is going in a rhythm. There is a force behind it. And this is not a surmise, it is a realization of our duties. Bhayadasya agni stapati, bhayat tapati surya, bhayad indrascha vayuscha, mrityurdhavati panchamaha. All these devatas who are bringing the rains, who are bringing the season, who are causing the birth and the death, all these devatas perform their duty out of the fear of that Supreme God who is Brahman, and we are all part of that Brahman. So this is the big power is there that is running this whole universe. So not to know this Brahman, which is inside ourselves as our Atma, our soul and this infinite Brahman, it is not different. We are part of that Brahman, and Brahman is part and parcel of our Atman. So without knowing it, we are knowing only one part, half of the creation, another half, the living half, the consciousness half. We do not know means we do not know the major part of the creation or of our own being. He, that teacher who instructs us about our Atman, about a real eternal self, he is called the Guru. We are always thinking that we are the body and the mind, and then we are feeding the body, we are taking care of the body, we attend to the health of the body. Without knowing, there is something other than the body also to which we must attend. That is our soul. I should know that I am the soul. What is this soul? The Gita says, na jayate na mriyate va kadachit nayam bhutva bhavita vana bhuya ajo nitya shashvato yam purano na hanyate hanyamane sharire. If the body dies, this Atman does not die. It does not take birth along with the body. It does not die with the body. It is eternal. It is infinite. It is everywhere. It is beyond birth and death. We are that infinite Atman. If I am the infinite Atman, I should know it. But all of us always are thinking, somebody thinks I am a baby, somebody thinks I am a young man or a woman, and somebody thinks I am a middle-aged person, somebody thinks I am old, somebody thinks though I am about to die, and somebody thinks oh I am already gone. This is the idea about ourselves. None of us think we are this eternal, unborn, infinite, full of joy and full of bliss, this Atman. None of us know this. Why do we not know it? We never want to know it. One of our Swamis was asked by one devotee. This devotee was a very senior devotee and very intimate with that Swami, very free with that Swami. So this Swami was also for several years in our ashram. One day she suddenly asked him, Swami, you have been here in this mission for 25 years. Have you realized God? He said, no, I have not. What? 25 years you have been here and you have not realized God. I said, I never wanted to realize God. That is why I did not realize. If I had really wanted, so I would have done what is to be done to realize God. I would have realized. So I did not. Then what were you doing? You see, I am doing the work of the mission. I have constructed this library building, the auditorium building, this hospital building. I never asked Sri Ramakrishna to reveal himself to me. I said, so let this building be done well. So please help me. So he helped me. So I have made this huge building. So one after each one worth some crores. So I have constructed all this. When my mind goes and then I ask for Sri Ramakrishna, you please reveal yourself to me, you will certainly relieve it. That Swami replied. That is how is it we do not know our Atman? Did any of us try to know our Atman? Have you ever asked the question to anybody, please allow us to know our Atman. Please help us to know our Atman. We never did it. When you don't want it, who will come and give you? Even the child, when it does not come to the mother, oh, I am hungry, mother will not give you milk. In Tamil, there is a saying, Adarakonadam pal kadikam. Adam virundu kudukumata. So the child must cry, then only mother will give the milk. Even in the case of an ordinary child and mother, if it is so, this infinite knowledge, how do we get unless we ask for it? And why don't we ask for it? We don't feel the need of it at all. We never want to know that there is something permanent about us. We are happy with these temporary things. So we are there, we have got enough things to enjoy through our five senses. We are very happy with this. So God also says, all right, be happy with that one. Only when we turn our mind away for some reason or other, no, I don't want this only sensual joys. I want something more permanent. I want something permanent which I can hold on to. I must get a joy which must be permanent with me. It should not change with age, change with the old age or young age. So I must have an unchanging, eternal joy. If you ask for it, then you have to do certain things. To achieve anything, to get any new knowledge, you have to undergo certain discipline. This discipline is called the spiritual practices. So the guru comes in our life and he teaches us certain disciplines which are not the usual worldly disciplines. In the worldly discipline, so you have to go and attend the college for say so many 16 years or 15 years to get a degree. And when you get a degree, you will get a job. When you get a job, you earn something. When you get earn something, you have some bank balance, you have got some property and you have got some house and you have got some position in society. This is the way of the world. So there also there is a particular way. You must follow the discipline. You don't go to the college at all. You don't get a degree at all. Will you get a job? You will not get a job. Why should I not get a job? But did you go to college? Did you get a degree? So you will not get a job. So you will suffer. So in the spiritual world also, just for asking you, I must know God. Nobody will be able to give you God knowledge. Suppose some doctor comes to you, says, I am an MD in medicine. Make me also an MD. Will you ask him? He will say, already go and get admitted into higher secondary, then joint examination, then medical college, then afterwards the MBBS, afterwards MD will come. This is the discipline. You have to go. We don't ask a doctor when we say, you are a doctor, you make me a doctor. How can I go and ask a saint, you make me realize God? That is also knowledge. That saint has realized it going through the disciplines for 50 years, 60 years, 70 years or perhaps several births. And he has realized God. You cannot just go and ask, please make me also God, knower of God. It is something like asking an MD, you make me an MD. Yes, you can become an MD. But discipline you must undergo. So saints also say, if you want to realize God, if you want to know that you are this infinite Atman, full of infinite joy, infinite life, infinite knowledge, infinite power, everything is inside you. You will have nothing more to aspire if you know who you are. To get this knowledge, there are certain disciplines. These disciplines are the spiritual discipline, and the person who teaches us this, he is called the Guru. This Guru comes to us when we need him, when we ask for him. Otherwise, when we don't want a teacher at all, so teacher will not come to you. So we get our Guru when we feel the need for it. When do we feel the need for a Guru? When we feel the need for something permanent, something eternal, something unchanging. So when we get tired about this joys and experiences of this world, they come and go, they come and go, they come and go. Nothing seems to be permanent. But we want something permanent. In the beginning, we are not aware of it. We think, oh, this will be permanent. But that also impermanent. Then again, we say, that may be permanent. You go and catch that. That also is Then we come to know when we become mature that everything in this world is impermanent. Anityam asukham lokam imam prapya bhajaswamam. Bhagavad Gita said, this world is changing, anitya. Therefore, it is miserable. That whichever changes, and whichever changes, it leaves you. It will change means that you cannot hold on to it. So, and then when it leaves you, you become miserable. That is what our experience in the world says. In the world, we cling on to something. Oh, this is my child. I am very happy with this child. I will be happy with this child all my life. That is wrong. Today you are happy with your child, we can accept. I will be happy all my life with my child. First of all, the child will not be a child all your life. You will not be the same mother which you are taking care of that child. You will also be an old lady or old father, old man. The whole thing is changing. The man, the ordinary young man changes into an old man. The child becomes a young man. So the whole relationship will change. Then, you know, we say, no, we want to be happy together. It cannot happen. So the young man says, I will go to Delhi. I want to build up my career. No, who will take care of me if you go away? But I cannot help that. So I have to build up my career. Mother, I have to live my own life. Your son says it. This is anityam, asukham, lokam. The son is not telling anything very illogical. It's perfect. When I say I want to build my career, I must go. away from you. When you expect, no, I have nobody to take care of. I was depending upon you. You are also right. You may be right, he may be right. He may be logical, he may be logical. But it does not happen. It is anitya, it should change. This is world. So with all our logic and reasonableness, world has its own way. Everything is changing, everything is impermanent. Man wants something permanent. It is this desire to have something permanent. Some person, some force, some energy, some love, which is permanent always with us, that we cry for. At that time the Guru comes. Yet that permanent being is inside yourself. That God, that Brahman, who is your father, who is your mother, who is your beloved, who is your everything, he is there inside you. It is part and parcel of your personality. You yourself are that Tattvamasi. This knowledge, this eye will be opened by the person who has realized it. Great people like Swami Vivekananda, his Guru Sri Ramakrishna, Holy Mother, such people, they have realized God. So they say that every one of you can realize inside you this infinite knowledge, infinite life and unchanging joy, unchanging love is there inside you. You turn your mind inside and know that you are that. So this is what is written in the Vedas, which are the experiences of hundreds and thousands of rishis. And this knowledge is revealed to us and they show us the path, how to experience this knowledge. He is called the Guru. The Guru is a person who has experienced the existence of God within himself. Ananya prokte gatiratra nasti aniyan hi atarkyam anupramanate. The Guru must be one who knows that God is not different from me. I am in God always. God is always with me. Sri Ramakrishna used to say this. Whenever he used to speak, if somebody said, why do you say like that, sir? I did not say. God told it through my tongue. It is Mother Kali who spoke to me. Many times Swami Vivekananda used to go and tell, why did you praise me like that before all, that I have got 18 powers when compared to that Keshav Chandra Sen? He is such a great man and everybody considers him as one of the greatest sons of Bengal, and you compare me with him and you say I am 18 times greater than him. This is all your infatuation. Then the simple reply Sri Ramakrishna says, I did not say that. It is Mother Kali who said it. God speaks through my mouth. It is such people who are the real gurus. So this great guru of this age is Sri Ramakrishna. So Sri Ramakrishna has come. So he had opened the door of the spirituality to all of us. So he came into the world. He realized this truth by tremendous sadhanas, unprecedented sadhanas, which is written down in his biography. When we read his biography, you cannot disbelieve that there is no God. You cannot be an atheist. He says, I saw him with his physical eyes also. His different forms I have seen. And then through the intuitional method, through samadhi, I have seen his infinite form, indescribable form, eternal form. Now I am living in God. Always I am in God. Whatever I speak is God's speech. He speaks through me. He lived like that amidst us, and he had disciples like Vivekananda, Brahmananda, etc. They got that knowledge. They could also say, we have seen God. We can make you also see God. And then their disciples were there. Those disciples also, they have instructed their disciples. It is coming like a heritage from the one guru to his disciple, from that disciple to his disciple. So this is the parampara, guru parampara. The Lord himself comes in every age as an avatara, an incarnation. So he has come as Rama, he has come as Buddha, he has come as Krishna, he has come as Christ, he has come as Chaitanya, now he has come as Sri Ramakrishna. These are all standing examples of these gurus. So those gurus, they instruct and they prepare many more gurus. We know that Sri Ramakrishna had 16 monastic disciples. hundreds of household disciples, they were also equal to gurus, because they had seen God. They could tell the others that we have seen God. Gopalayar Ma, one old lady, she used to play with Krishna, she used to talk with Krishna, she would move with Krishna, she would come to Sri Ramakrishna and show, see, I am carrying this Gopala with me. Sri Ramakrishna would call that Gopala, you come, and this Gopala would go to Sri Ramakrishna, and Sri Ramakrishna would play with him. Again, this old lady, she would take her Gopala and go away. So, this is true, so palpable was the existence of God for this householder lady. She was a child widow. She could realize God. She could feel, experience God. You see, that is how Sri Ramakrishna established the real religion. It was Sri Ramakrishna who said, religion does not lie in simply dogmas and doctrines or in reading books. Religion is realization. He that has not realized God, so he cannot instruct others. Just like a person who has not entered the laboratory and then done experiments and then got his doctorate. Except such person, nobody else can teach the other person to become another doctorate. So a person who has experienced science in the laboratory through hard work, he can only make another doctorate. Similarly, Sri Ramakrishna used to say, religion is like that. A person who has realized God, who can say, I have experienced God, he can only give that knowledge to others. So that is how the direct disciples of Sri Ramakrishna came. They also instructed their disciples, next generation of disciples. So the parampara is there in our modern age also, that religion is true. Religion lies in realization. Realization is possible for every human being. That is the great message of Sri Ramakrishna. Sri Ramakrishna's message is, this religious experience is open to every human being, irrespective of his race, religion, caste, creed, color, gender. Nothing stops. Any human being can realize this highest spiritual reality, or the ultimate truth, which we call as God. God is none but infinite joy, infinite life, infinite knowledge and power. So that is what we are all after. We want joy. How much joy do you want? The maximum joy that you can have in the human body is 100 years. Afterwards, you don't want joy. You want joy. But of all, to enjoy the joy, first of all, you must live after this body goes. That means you must become, first of all, eternal. You must know that you are your eternal being. We want eternal life first. With this eternal life, we want to enjoy infinite knowledge and infinite joy. And Sri Ramakrishna says it is possible to every human being. So this is the goal of real religion. This is the goal of real goal of human beings. All of us human beings, we want joy in our life. Otherwise, why are we running here and there from morning 8 o'clock to evening 8 o'clock? We struggle hard, either in a shop or either in a laboratory or in an office or in a factory. What for? We want joy. We want to live happily. We want to live peacefully. But that all that we are aspiring for is only short-lived. Sri Ramakrishna comes, if you want to live eternally. There should be no question of death at all. You realize that you have an eternal life. If you want joy, go for that joy which will never leave you. In this body or without this body also, you can be enjoying that joy. And if you want knowledge and power, go for that knowledge and power, which will be infinite power, infinite knowledge. All that is in your soul. Know that you are the soul. Now we are thinking we are the body. So body is only it is only transient. It is only short-lived. So when we think we are the body, we always think, oh, our life also is only short-lived. So I have already lived 90 years of the 100 years. Only 10 are left for me. And I am unhappy, only 10 are there. And some other people who are thinking, no, we have got 50 before us. We have nothing to worry. But they cannot be very sure about that 50. By calculation, you may be having 50. But how do you know that you will really get those 50? Only after 10, 60 itself may be the end. So everything is so short-lived. Therefore, the scriptures, which is the experience of all God, the saints and seers, they say, anityam asukam lokam. So it is transitory, it is only transient. So for a short period only is our life. When our life itself is very short-lived, everything is short-lived. So the main point of spiritual life comes that I must become eternal. I must become an ever-living entity. I should not have any death. I must become immortal. Immortality is the goal. Unless I am immortal, I cannot have infinite joy and infinite knowledge and power. Infinite knowledge and power, infinite joy, it is there in the soul itself. When soul knows I am immortal, I am eternal, I will always be there. You will always be full of joy. You will always be full of knowledge and power. That is what we want, but we are mistaking that one for our body. So we want to get power and knowledge here. How much of it can you exercise with the body? So you have got the power of the eyes. So when you become 60 or 70 or 80, so eyes become weak. Your power is gone. Similarly, the other senses also. When we think we are body and senses, it is only transient, limited, and short-lived. Whereas when we begin to know that we are that immortal soul, then I live forever. So infinite is my life. So infinity is my life. And with this infinite life, I am ever living. So I am enjoying. There is no end to my enjoyment at all. Infinite enjoyment. Similarly, I am acquiring knowledge more and more. There is no end to my knowledge. Infinite knowledge. Knowledge means power. Infinite power. Everything is there in our immortal soul. And we are that soul. This idea that you are not the body, you are the soul. This idea, whoever can give to us, he is the real guru. He opens the eyes. Gurus will come and then will you give you a success in your examination, or they will help you to get an IAS job, or they will shave you from a court case. That is not the purpose of the guru. There are so many other people to do it. Whereas the guru's main purpose is, he will open your eyes. You are not your body which is going to die. You are not going to become old. You take to spiritual practices. When you realize that you are the Atman, you will clearly see that you are an eternal being. You are never born, you will never die. You are an eternal being. So being an eternal being, you are inside you, is infinite joy and infinite knowledge and power. This is the real realization, the goal of human life. So the Guru comes and opens our eyes to this dimension of ours. So that is why the Lord Himself comes. So He demonstrates that everyone can realize this one. You see the disciples of Sri Ramakrishna. Disciples of Sri Ramakrishna, there are every type of people are there. Men are there, women are there, householders are there, sannyasins are there, vanaprasthas are there, brahmacharins are there, young are there, old are there, of different castes, communities, from different religions also. So many people come to Him who are Muslims are there, Christians are there. They are all enlightened by Sri Ramakrishna. To prove every human being must have this goal of realizing himself as this infinite Atman. We are that soul. This soul is part and parcel of that infinite soul, Paramatma. So God and our human soul, it is one. God is with us always. We are in God always. This is the realization. That is the goal of our life. So Sri Ramakrishna always, whenever people used to go, he would ask the question, what do you think the goal of human life? Many people could not answer, including some of the most intelligent people of his time. He asked this question to Bankim Chandra Chattopadhyaya, who had written 20 books, and he had analyzed the human life and the goal of life, how men should live. All that, you know, he has discussed in his novels. Very famous writer. When Bankim Chandra Chatterjee was asked by Sri Ramakrishna, what is the goal of human life? He just in a light way, he said, sir, eating, drinking and merrymaking. He said, what? You consider yourself as an intelligent man and you are telling this is the goal of life, eating, drinking and merrymaking? What you eat, you belch. So if you eat radish, you will belch radish. So that is how you are engaging yourself in eating, drinking and merrymaking. You say that is the goal of life. That is not the goal of life. The goal of life is to realize God, that all infinite joy, infinite knowledge and infinite life is inside you. You must realize this. That is the goal of life. You see, the most intelligent man of that time, so he could also immediately say, the goal of human life is spiritual realization, to know that you are the child of God. You yourself are God. God is in you always, and you are eternal with God. If God is all joy, you are also all joy. If God is all powerful, you are also all powerful. God is eternal, you are also eternal. This great ideal was made so real to us by Sri Ramakrishna. And earlier team, all the great avatars did the same thing. And their disciples, they carried that banner. They brought that message to others. So in this age, Sri Ramakrishna has brought this knowledge of God as a true knowledge, which should be the aim of our life. So Sri Ramakrishna taught us how to attain to this knowledge. He has given us simple way, simple disciplines to follow. And he never asked all of us to renounce the world and go away. Though many of his main disciples were all monks, they had renounced the world. Sri Ramakrishna never meant that everybody must renounce the world. There were hundreds of disciples of him who had realized God, who had realized that they are children of God, who had realized that we are eternal children of God. Inside us there is infinite joy and infinite knowledge and infinite life. Hundreds of his household disciples had realized this one. And that is what Sri Ramakrishna told. Every one of us must have the goal of spiritual emancipation or spiritual knowledge as the goal. So having that before us, I must achieve this spiritual knowledge that I am eternal and I have infinite joy inside me, I have infinite knowledge inside me. This knowledge must come to me before the end of this life. So we must have this ideal. Having that ideal, how should we live in this world? Sri Ramakrishna says, in this world you can live simultaneously thinking our goal is that. To achieve that goal, there are certain spiritual disciplines. Sri Ramakrishna has given that. I am not going into that detail. If you read the Gospel of Sri Ramakrishna, he tells you the simple discipline. And if you live with those disciplines, you earn whatever you want to earn for your life, make your life comfortable in this world. You live a comfortable life in this world, but the goal is not to lead a comfortable life in this world. Goal is to realize that we are all children of God. We are Atman. We are not this body and the mind. We must be ready to give up this body and mind when the time comes. All of us know a time will come. We must give up this body and mind, and we have to go from where we have come. But we don't think about it at all. Sri Ramakrishna says, no, think about it. Because something is there imminent. So we know that the train is going to stop at Chennai. You have started from Delhi. So it is going to come and reach Chennai. You are somewhere near Guntur or Nagpur somewhere. So if you forget that you have to get down at Chennai, you don't get ready at all. Then, you know, when the Chennai station comes, everybody has got down. You are not aware at all Chennai has come. So you have to get down. It is not going to go beyond it. You have reached the goal. You have to get down from here. So you must get ready right from when you reach, if not Nagpur itself, much earlier. When you come somewhere near Hyderabad, you can just get ready. So now Chennai is not very far. Like that, in this life, we must get ready to face the end of our life with courage, with joy. That can come only when you know what is beyond the life. Beyond the life is immortality. Our knowledge that we are immortal souls. So the body only goes, we are there. We were in this body, now we leave this body, we are there free. Without this body itself we can live. In fact, we are living. This body is obstructing us. in all our movements, I should be able to see from here what is happening in all the seven worlds, which is described in our Puranas. But I am not able to see beyond half a mile. And the half a mile, so people are unable to see even a few yards also. They want to have spectacles. They want to have some other equipments to see. We are restricted from our real glory. So we must know that we are in a bondage. To go out of this body must be great joy. That is how Swamiji said. He gave up the body. On the same moment he came, he appeared before Ramakrishnananji in this very place. Ramakrishnananji was in the ice house. He was meditating. Sri Swami Vivekananda appeared in his spiritual body. He said, Shashi, I have given up that physical body. Now I am in the spiritual body. He is announcing it. We must also be able to announce it. I have thrown away that physical body. I am here. Come. What do you want? All your relatives will be shivering. What is this? So, now we thought, once and for all, we have got rid of that person, but he is there. The eternal spiritual body, we are there. It is true. It has happened. It should happen. When you know that we are the spiritual persons, we will not die with the body. We throw this body away. We continue to live. We are now here. Next moment we are in the loka where Sri Ramakrishna is there. We can go to the loka of Jesus. We can go to the loka where Buddha is there. Anywhere. Yam smarati. Whatever you think, you are there at the very moment. This is our real stature. All this can be realized by everyone by knowing that he is the soul. And there is a way for it. That way is the spiritual discipline explained by these people in a very simple way to us. They are the real gurus. The gurus, they open our eyes to our spiritual side. We think that we are bodies. They say, no, you are not the body. You are really, you are the soul. You are sitting inside a body. Why do I sit? That is a different thing. For so many reasons, you are sitting inside the body. And you are getting attached to your body. So sometimes we live long in a rented house. We get so much attached. So then we construct a house also. And then when we want to go to that house, we have to empty this house and leave. I have seen people weeping. This is a rented house. They have built their own house. They are going to their real house. But they are weeping also. Elders are weeping. Looking at the elders, youngers are also weeping. All of them are weeping. How do you explain it? It is there. That feeling is there. This is how we have got entangled in our body. When we know that there is a spiritual body for us, we are eternal. We have nothing to do with this body. Even then we are attached to this body. Oh, we are leaving this body. So we weep. Oh, we become old. So death has come. So it is difficult. I am afraid of death. All this is like weeping for a rented house. How foolish it is. But here we are really foolish. Because we are not so clear about our own real stature. The Guru comes and opens our eyes. A Sri Ramakrishna, a Vivekananda, their disciples. They come and tell us, you practice spiritual discipline. You go through daily some japa, meditation, prayers. Then spend some time with the illumined persons. Go to the ashramas. Celebrate where, you know, wise people will come and tell you about their wisdom. That they have really seen God in certain aspects. Hear about that. If this is also goes along with our worldly life. We have our worldly experiences also and duties. Along with that one, if we can go on hearing about God also and doing something for God realization also, a time will come. Naturally, this our attachment to our body and to this world and worldly things will go. They go on getting reduced and our interest in our soul, interest in God, interest in our relationship with God, and the knowledge that we belong to God, we have absolutely nothing to worry. We were with God, we have come into this world for a short period, we are going back to our God. That is our true nature. This knowledge will slowly open up and we become more and more fearless, more and more free, more and more ready to leave this world and go. At the same time, live in this world also. Without any fear, carefree. This is the great boon of spiritual life. This the Guru will open up. When we become spiritual and the spiritual eye is opened, spiritual path is shown to us by such realized souls. They are the real gurus. They are never absent from this world, and they are found in maximum number in our country, because we are a spiritual country. So when the whole world is producing scientists, physicists and chemists and doctors and other people in the computer world or in the other gadgetry, we are ready producing spiritual giants, a Ramana, an Aravindo, a Vivekananda, numberless. They are going on. Everywhere you go, Swami, there is a person who has realized God here. Everywhere you go, you hear about it. And those people that have realized also, they have not also gone. They now and then appear. Here Vivekananda appears to somebody. So he comes and says, Swamiji, I saw Vivekananda. He came and gave instruction. Aurobindo was in the jail in Alipur. So for one month he saw Swami Vivekananda there, in the jail, instructing him in yoga. He has written in, Aurobindo does not write a lie. He has written his real experience. He says, one full month I saw Swami Vivekananda in his spiritual body. So if Vivekananda appears there, why should he not appear to us also? He will appear. So Sri Ramakrishna was seen by one Kansas lady in America, one agriculturist lady. Her father left a big agricultural farm. He died. There was nobody else to take care of the big farm. This girl, his only daughter, so she knew something about agriculture. She said, let me manage this farm. So she was managing, and somehow she thought she must go to Hollywood for some work. She went to Hollywood, and there she went into our Vedanta Society of Southern California, the Hollywood. Then she got a copy of Gospel of Sri Ramakrishna. So she read. As she read, she thought, oh, the spirituality life is so easy, so simple. And Sri Ramakrishna is there to instruct you. He is not dead, he is living. So if I weep for him, he will reveal himself to me. This conviction came into her. She went on reading pages after pages. She would not keep that book down. She completed that book, came back to Kansas, which is near St. Louis. We have our sub-center there. St. Louis Center has got a sub-center there. I have been there also. Our Swami, he met this lady. This lady came and said, Swami, it happened like this. I read that whole of gospel. I went on weeping to Sri Ramakrishna, you please show me the way. You reveal yourself to me. You show me the spiritual path. And Sri Ramakrishna appeared to me. And he has given me the instruction. And he has given me a mantra also. Then the Swami asked, what was that mantra? She tells that mantra. And he knows that he has in a parampara that mantra is being given. Sri Ramakrishna has given it to his disciple. His disciples have given to their disciples. It has come down to us. The Swami knows that mantra, correct mantra. She has got it directly from Sri Ramakrishna. As if, you know, Sri Ramakrishna didn't get any devotee here. He goes and first searches out some agriculturist lady there. She goes and gives that mantra. What does that mean? It is an eternal process, eternal phenomenon. God is there permanently. We only have to desire God. We want to cry to God, pray to God sincerely. He is there to help you. So when she in Kansas can get Sri Ramakrishna, when somebody in Alipur jail will get Swami Vivekananda, we can also get Sri Ramakrishna or Buddha or Christ or Muhammad, whomsoever we want, we can get. We can get instruction, become illumined and enjoy this eternal joy. The person who gives this knowledge is the Guru. It is that Guru we celebrate today. When we come here, we must develop this faith that there is a higher goal for life. What we are doing is all right, but that's not enough. We must open our spiritual eye also. We must progress in our spiritual quest to realize that we are with God and God is with us. So the goal of human life is not only physical joy and physical comfort. It is this infinite joy, infinite life, and infinite knowledge which is in the soul. All of us must realize this spiritual knowledge that we are souls, we are part and parcel of God, or we are God Himself. It is to open our eyes for this. God comes in the form of incarnation and establishes organizations like Sri Ramakrishna Mata, Sri Ramakrishna Mata and Mission. It is meant for awakening people that there is a spiritual goal for life. So your secular goal is all right, but that's not enough. Have the spiritual goal also, struggle for both, and the instructions are given by the gurus. So it is on such days like this Guru Purnima day, we remember that we have a spiritual goal and we can achieve it. All the things that are know-how about that is there available with these great masters of spirituality, Sri Ramakrishna and his generations of gurus. So let us go and take refuge under them, take the instructions that are there already. There are hundreds of gurus who can instruct us, take us by steps. So let us advance in spiritual life also, along with our secular life. Secular life you don't have to neglect. You hold on to secular life also, but don't be satisfied only with that one. Advance in spiritual life also. A time will come, automatically the secular life will go away. Only spiritual life is left with us. Because we find all joy in that spiritual life itself. A time will come, it is not of a maturing. When you mature, then you automatically you leave this lower joys of the secular life. Higher joy, spiritual life will come. So on this sacred day, let us pray to Sri Ramakrishna that he will guide us into the spiritual life step by step from wherever we are, and may we all realize the real goal of life, that is our spiritual nature and our infinite and eternal relationship with God himself. So may all of us realize God as the goal of our life, God as our own, and we as belonging to him and he belonging to us. May Sri Ramakrishna, Holy Mother, Swamiji and all the gurus bless us. Thank you very much.